So FOAMSEE, it's an experiment on foams. You know, foams are a collection of bubbles. People don't realize that they see foam bubbles and they wonder why scientists would be interested by soap bubbles. Children like them very much. But, you know, it's scientifically, it's a very interesting system. And it has so many applications. Fuzzy beverages, meringue, cakes, bread, all these are foams. You have them in for detergency. For instance, you can have, if you want to clean your car, there are machines that use foams and they are very, very efficient. You have foams for oil recovery. Inject foams to push the oil outside of the reservoir. This is very much used. They use CO2 foams to be compatible with the petroleum. Firefighting. This is not a new application, but it's very important because it's more or less the only way to extinguish the fires from organic materials. You know, organic solvents, you cannot use water. So people use foam. And foam, they work because you cover the fire with foam. So you prevent the transfer of oxygen from the outside to what is burning inside. And so since you have no oxygen, you know, the fire stops. All these are liquid foams, but you have also foams that are solid, that they are made in the liquid state and then solidified. So you can just think about foam for insulation, thermal insulation, foam for cushions, for mattresses. All these things are foams, so they are generally polymer foams. So it's a really very big industry. You can foam almost everything. You know, you can foam concrete to have it lighter and resistant. Plaster, you can foam plaster. And glass, nature has found a way to foam glass. This is pumice, and it's just a lava that was solidified with a lot of gas that was trapped inside. So it makes this kind of foam, glass foams. But there are many applications of glass foams. They are, very resistant, good insulator for heat, for electricity. And I forgot one of the most interesting and more recent ones for medicine. You know, if you have a cut on your skin, you can apply a foam and it prevents, you know, contamination and also air to come to with oxygen, you know, and to so it favors healing. And now it's even used during operation, you know, internal operation, when you cut an organ and you need it to heal and not to bleed for too long, then you can use foam. So foams are everywhere. It's a small box. And in this very small box, you have a carousel with 20 cells, the cells where the foams are made, so they are filled with the solution of the soap. And then there is a piston that is actuated with a magnet that goes back and forth and make the foam. And there is a little part that is a cube at the top where we look at the foam. We have a laser. We look at the transmission, at the reflection, at correlation function, you know, sophisticated devices. And we also have a camera that looks at the top window to see how the foam is behaving, measure the bubble size. So the carousel rotates. So each time we finished one cell, it rotates, and then we study another one. At the top, in the middle, you see the Columbus section of the ISS. This is the European section. And in the Columbus, you have several racks, like one that is on the left, and it's called Fluid Science Laboratory, FSL. And below that, you see the experiment container, and it goes into this fluid science laboratory. At the side of the experiment container, you see the cell. Cells, foam cells are grouped 4x4. You also have VMU. This is the video monitor unit that connects the FSL and the instrument to the Columbus. And then it goes into, if you look on the right, you see an antenna. Means that this is the way the results that are digitalized go to the Earth's surface. And then they go to BUSOC, the Belgium center where the data are received, and who control also the experiment, how it, you know, how to change the cell, to rotate the carousel, etc. And then there is another arrow, and this is us, the science team. We get all these data and we have to analyze them. That was the first phone picture that we got from the ISS. This is the picture of the top window of the little cell. So you see all the bubbles. And this, when we saw that last March, we were so happy. I cannot tell you to see that, you know, that we were getting foam in the ISS. That was very promising. And indeed, everything went on very well for the first phase of the experiment. So if you, for instance, take a bath, you have a lot of foam, and you see that very quickly this foam becomes very dry with bubbles with very little liquid. The liquid goes down because of gravity. So it's impossible to study foams containing substantial amount of liquid on Earth. So in this cartoon, you see the principle of the experiment. There are images going from liquid fraction that is zero, so just air, to 100%, so this is just water. And in between, you see you have all the different aspects of the system. For very small liquid fraction, you have these bubbles that are not spherical, that are distorted, like the ones that you could see when you have a bath with foam. And then if you add more liquid, you start seeing better the liquid. And then you reach an interesting point here, which is the limit above which you get, you know, spherical bubbles. These are bubbly liquids, you know, like when you drink, you know, champagne, you see the bubbles that are going up. There are not many bubbles and they are all spherical. And we are interested in the transition, you know, between these two. It's a very interesting transition. It's called jamming transition. So you see it in many other systems, even, you know, with cars, you know, cars that get jammed in the highway. So this is a transition before it's fluid and then prop, it doesn't move anymore. Mm-hmm. You also have the problem with sand. Sometimes sand flow and sometimes it's stuck. So it's a very universal transition that it's not very well known. And this is one thing that we went to study, this jamming transition, understand what happens there. Most people that make foam materials, they want to have more than a few percent of liquid in there. They want to have, let's say, 50%. So since they destabilize very rapidly on Earth, there is no knowledge, no scientific knowledge on the, how these wet foams behave. And so we think that understanding better these wet foams, we could, you know, produce some models, theories that will help all the people who study use applications to understand better. Because what I can say is that for the time being, the applications are based on know-how, you know, it's purely empirical. So if we can explain better what's happening in this wet foam, I think it will be very useful. If you want to make a metallic foam, these are not so new. You have them in BMW cars. You know, this contains 50% metal and 50% air. And they are very light and very resistant. And so they are made, of course, you have to melt the metal. You blow air inside, and you make the foam, and then you end with very interesting materials that are light and resistant. It's important to know what's happening in these foams, because on Earth, you know, the metal also, because of gravity, separate very rapidly. So this needs to be optimized, and it's not that simple. We have two samples that were, you know, we had little problems during recording, so we want to study them again. And we have made a lot of new samples. Now we want to do more, to change more the system. So we have system with, we are adding glycerin to the water to make it more viscous, to see how the wet foams are behaving. So we will study particular systems that are foam emulsions, you know, foams that contain little droplets of oil, very small ones compared to the bubbles. It will allow us to understand what the little particles in between the bubbles are doing during the foam evolution. So it's essentially to change the chemistry. Absolutely. And well, we were so happy to see the experiment working very well in the first phase. So we are very excited to see, to have new knowledge, you know, with the new type of samples. So we hope that everything will work as well as during the first phase. And we are especially excited because we learned that Thomas Pesquet, our French astronaut, was going to install the cells into the box.